Rosemary Franklin was one of the prettiest women who ever lived. And she wouldn't give me the time of day. She didn't care whether I wrote Mary Had a Little Lamb. So I thought, well, what if I wrote a song for her? So I wrote a song for her, and I invited her over to the Dorchester Hotel, and I had flowers, and I had champagne, and I played the song for her, and I put my arm around her, and I figured I had her pretty much where I wanted her. And I said, "What do you think, darling?" And she said, "Oh," she said, "well, I think it's silly." And I said, "You think it's what?" And she said, "Oh, isn't it silly?" Now, I'm heartbroken. I'm on the plane. I'm going home. The same stewardess comes up. "Mr. Webb, would you like some champagne?"
"No."
And she's like, "How about a copy of Rolling Stone?"
"I guess so."
She gave me a copy of Rolling Stone, and there it says, "Simon and Garfunkel, Splitsville." And I went, "Oh, my God! I was my girlfriend and my favorite group." And I'm sitting there looking at this jaggedy picture with this Artie's on one side, Paul's on the other side. And I'm looking at it, thinking, "Oh, well, now wait a minute. Let's see. Paul Simon, he writes words and he writes all the songs. And the tall, curly haired guy, it's the beautiful highlights. He's the singer. He's going to be needing some songs." And I cheered right up, ladies and gentlemen. Just that the way the songwriter's mind works. All of a sudden, it wasn't such a bad day after all. A few hours, quick plane change found me in San Francisco at a studio where Artie is sequestered and listening to material for his new album, his solo album. The first time he's ever sung without Paul. And as I walk into the studio, Graham Nash and David Crosby are walking out. And I'm thinking, "Oh my God, am I in this league and do I have anything to play for you?" And I went, and I certainly am not going to play that silly song. And so I went in and I played every song that I, all my new stuff, cooking stuff, not all my Simon and Garfunkel ripoffs, because like I could write any kind of a song you wanted, you know, and say, "Give me a Simon Garfunkel song." "Oh, you got it." "Give me a Dionne Warwick song." "Oh, okay." Because I'm old school songwriter, pure songwriter. I'm not like singer songwriter. I'm a songwriter. "All right, well, write me a Broadway show." "Okay, when do you want it?" I'm not bragging, but that's what I wanted to be, and that's what I became. And so I went in, I played all my Artie Garfunkel stuff and came up empty, and I thought, "Oh my God." And he doesn't like it. I think he's gonna throw me out of here. And I haven't got a record. And I thought, "What's the most beautiful song that I can think of?" And at some wild impulse, I thought of "Come Thou Fount." It's actually, the full title is "Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing." It's in the Baptist hymnal. And it's the most gorgeous tune that I've ever heard. It goes like this. Two ways about it, and I'm going da 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 da, and he goes, "I love that." He said, "I love that." He said, and I went, "Oh my God, I've stolen one of God's songs." I had these flashbacks, you know, when I was a Baptist preacher kid. I wasn't that hard oiled yet, you know, and I thought, and all of a sudden I thought, "Oh my God," I thought, "that silly song." That silly song is like, that's like a hymn. That's definitely Irish DNA. I was playing that because I was desperate, and I played, "I'll bruise you, was me. We both grew so easily.
Short version.